software developer at Unicode. So today we are going to talk about how we can document and how we can create our own sandbox mode using Swagger. Okay. Before we start, let me ask you a question. How many of you know what is API? Okay. So how many of you know what is sandbox? Let me tell you what is API and what is sandbox. API, which stands for Application Program Interface. Correct? API is a middleware between your client and a server. For example, if you all are VTU students, right? Most of you visit VTU page to see a result. So you go and add your USN and click on the get result. Correct? On click of get result, what happens? The API call has been made between your client to a server, where your server will return your result and which is going to display in the browser, right? It's basically a middleware between one module to another module. Now what is sandbox, right? So literal meaning of a sandbox is a box which is filled with the sand. It's given for the children to play with, right? So why this concept came? In order to tell the children the feeling of a playground with the limited environment and with the limited requirements, right? In the similar fashion, when it comes to a software development, what is sandbox? So you will build an API using different technologies, different framework, right? So, and those APIs, your end users or someone other developer from your team are going to use those APIs, right? How will they know that? How this API is going to work? The sandbox is nothing but it's a playground for them in order to play with your API. How is the request and how is the response? By giving this request, what kind of response I am getting? That is called a sandbox. So today we will see how we can create our own sandbox mode using Swagger. So before we start, let me tell you, has anyone worked on Swagger? Has anyone heard about Swagger? Okay, fine. So we'll see what is Swagger and why we use Swagger. So today's agenda is, we'll see first why Swagger and what Swagger UI and its advantages and how Swagger UI basically works. Then I'll show you the demo, that is nothing but a sandbox. Then I'll show you the dev process where you can create your own sandbox mode using the Swagger. Then I'll talk some of the alternatives for the Swagger UI. Then at the end, we'll have the question and answer session. So why Swagger? Swagger is an open source framework which can be used to design your API, build, document, and test your APIs. The complete API lifecycle can be done using Swagger. Swagger removes the guesswork by allowing you test before the implementation. What do you mean by that? For example, if you have built some of the APIs and your end customer or developers are going to use it, right? So how you will tell them to that how these APIs are working? What is the response of this API? What is the version of this API? What is the name of this API? What is the URL of this API, right? So either you will write in the Google Docs, either you will write it in the Markdowns and give it to them. Right? Then what they are going to do? They'll start the trial and error. Okay, I will implement in my project. Then I will call this API, it'll connect to either curl. And then they'll start trial and error, right? Which we can avoid using the Swagger, because Swagger which gives you a complete visual where you can test your APIs. That's what I was integrating with the playground with the sandbox, right? They can play with your APIs. Free and open source framework. So whenever I tell it's a free and open source framework, what is the first thing comes to a developer? How is the community support, right? If I'm going to include this in my project, what is the community support? If I'm going to include, then what if I get tomorrow some issues? Then how I'm going to solve this? Since this is a Linux founded collaborated project, there are thousands of developers who are continuously working on this to make the project more reliable and scalable. So if you get any of the issues, you can just create an issue in the GitHub. There are developers who will solve for you. Framework which allow you to design your new API. okay, you get a some of the requirements to build an API, right? So you have to come up with a some of the detailed design of that. What will be the name of the API? What will be the version of the API? And what will be the response of the API? Those detailed documentation you can do by using the Swagger editor. Then Swagger CodeGen. Swagger CodeGen is another framework which allow you to build entire your API using 40 different languages. You can pick any of the languages where you can build your own API. Swagger UI, documenting API. This Swagger UI which allow you to document and create your own sandbox mode. This is what we are going to talk more on this today. Swagger UI, how we can create our own sandbox mode. And Swagger Inspector. Swagger Inspector is a testing framework which will allow you to test your APIs irrespective whether it has been built using the Swagger CodeGen or by your own framework. Right? So the Swagger Inspector even allow you to automate your testing process. So let's talk today more on Swagger UI, where we can create our own sandbox mode. So what is Swagger UI and its advantages? So Swagger UI is a client-side project which is built on the React.js. Allow you to visualize and interact with the API, right? As I told you, which will give you a complete visual picture by call just by clicking the button of execute. You will see by calling this API, I am getting the this kind of response, right? For the response will be segregated based on the status code. For 200, what is the response? For if you get any internal server error, then what will be the response? Those everything will be documented. The one is going to adopt your APIs, right? Those can just look into this detailed design or a sandbox and they will understand, okay, this API is going to return me these kind of data. So they can plan according to the development process, they can plan accordingly that. So it will completely helpful for the end user who is going to adopt your APIs. Swagger UI is fully customizable. So since it's an open source framework, right? So everyone has a complete source code access. So, and since it will allow you to tweak the UI. So there are some of the developers in GitHub, they are working on like making the Swagger UI look better by adding into material design. So even if you are interested, even you can just clone the repo and you can work on that. All browser support. Since I mentioned Swagger is a client-side project, right? So whenever you are building any of the UI project, what is the biggest challenge we face? Browser compatibility, right? Some of the feature will work in this project browser, some of the feature will work in this, some of the function work in a different way, right? But not in this case, where Swagger UI, Swagger developers has taken care that all the functionality of Swagger will be supported in all the browsers. Swagger UI allows you to document API in the two ways. Swagger open source, which we are going to see the demo and we are going to build our own sandbox using that, and one more is the Swagger Hub. So as I mentioned, Swagger is an online platform where you can write your API documentation and give it to the Swagger community, where Swagger community will host that your sandbox into their server. Okay, since there are some of the limitations you can do with the Swagger Hub, it's better to always use the Swagger open source. Since it's open source, everyone can use the Swagger open source. Okay, let me say how Swagger UI works. Since it's a client-based project, a web server and a web browser is enough to run this project. If you are running any of the web application, you need a web server, right? So you have to configure the one web server. This is very minimal and one-time setup. You don't have to install thousands of things to run this project. Just one web browser is there, then it's more than enough. Then how you are going to write a documentation, right? So you can write a documentation by using the specification, API specification. Now what are these API specification? These API specifications, when I say API specification, these are the properties of API. Okay, so your API name is this one, your API URL, my API response is this. Those are the properties of your APIs, right? Status code and the version, those are the properties of API. So this specification, the Swagger specification, is also called as an open API specification. Okay, so in order to write this specification, there are two ways we can write. Either JSON or YML. Okay, so how exactly the sandbox is going to create just by writing this specification? Since we are going to include the Swagger UI framework into our project, okay, so what Swagger UI basically it will do is the specification what you are writing in the YAML or JSON format, that will automatically render and it adds an HTML, CSS and JavaScript to that and it will render into the browser. So it will give you the detailed UI. So you don't have to write any of the JavaScript, HTML or CSS code. You just need to write a YML or YAML. That's it. The your entire sandbox is ready, right? So let's see a demo. I will show you how sandbox actually looks like. Then we'll start the development process. So today for this development, I have created two APIs. One is API which returns the all subjects of all 4 year subjects of engineering. Okay. The another one which returns for a specific year. You have to pass a year in the parameter. Most of them attended morning GraphQL session, right? He has created the API slash books.
Yeah.
Correct? That API. Here I have slash subjects. That's it. There is nothing different. So and this is how my sandbox looks like. Okay. Since I didn't do any of the tweak or UI styles, this is looks like a little old kind. If you are good in CSS, you can just do a, you can include the material theme into that. So if you see here, OAS 3, right? I just told about Open API Specification 3, right? So you guys know that stands for OAS 3. Now, list all the subjects. This is what? This is my API name and the version. This is my first version of API. You are going to release the another version, V1, V2, those kinds. So you, this I have not written a single line of any JavaScript, HTML or CSS. This is just a, I wrote a YML file. Okay, and here you have a description of API, what exactly this API does. So whoever looking into this UI, they will clearly understand that, okay, by calling this API, this kind of data I'm going to get. And this is the requirements for this API. This description is a markdown description. Everyone know about markdown, right? .md, this thing. So where you can bold your letters, you can style, italic, and you can even provide the hyperlinks. Since this description is a markdown, you can create all those bold, and you can see I have created some of the words in order to show the demo as a bold. Then the second thing is a server. Okay, this server where I have hosted my API. Right now I have developed my API in my local system. Since it says localhost 500 and version is v1, that is my host name where the API is actually hosted. Then my API is a subject slash subject. It will be v1 slash subjects, right? And it's a get method. So everyone know about the methods, right? Get and post, those. So it's simple get method. So my simple get API, so how we can document it using that? If you click on this get method, so you see here parameter, right? Which is token and description for authenticating the request. Your API might accept some of the parameters. Right. In my case, my API is going to accept the token. For I'm going to authenticate who and all are going to call this API. I'm going to authenticate those APIs, right? So that accepts this token as a parameter, which is going to accept in the query parameter. Okay. So you see here red required field. That means they will. Anyone can understand by looking at that required field that this is a compulsory when you are going to make an API call for this one, this API, right? And this is all about the request, how you can create, how your API is there. But how your API is going to return the data, response, right? There are scenarios like your API might return different responses for different scenarios, right? I have segregated my API based on the status code, correct? So for status code 200, what kind of response it is returning? For status code 400, what kind of response it is returning? So by looking into this, okay, whenever they make an API call, if the status code is 200, then this is the dummy data, mock data, they will understand that, okay, this kind of data I'm returning, this API will return. so that they can start their development process, they can start their design implementation by looking into this. Think that if they are going to store your responses into a database, right, they need to know what kind of data you are sending, because they have to create a data types for each column, correct? So if they are going to data types, for example, in my case, this API is written in three properties: status, message, and data. Okay, status, what is the status? Its status will be either success or failure. It describes the your API call, if it is if you did something wrong or something wrong happened with your server, then what you the status will be failure.
Can see over.
Even I can't see, man. I'm right in the front row.
So yeah, you should speak up. No, I came out here because my session is coming. You should see. You're not understanding all this thing here. This is not college. This is no attendance for you. You're coming out of your own free will, right, to learn something. To ensure you're getting learned. Oh, is that proper English?
Okay, so my API is going to return three types of properties. One is status, message, and data. As I told, if they are going to store this into the database, they should know that what kind of data type this API is always returning. So if you click on the model here, it will tell you which property is returning what kind of status. Right? For status, it is string. Always it will return a string. And message, obviously it is a string. Then data, it's a, by looking at this you will know this is a JSON response, right? JSON object. In a similar fashion, for other response code, we can document, okay, for status code 400, what is the response, right? And for authentication failure, if they pass a wrong token or your token has expired that time, what kind of response they will get. And 400, if the API you not yet build it, and if they are making a call to your server, you will throw 404, not found, right? That time, what kind of response they are getting? Those entire documentation will be available here. Okay, let me try out this API and see how it looks. Now here you see a try it out button, right? On click of this try it out button, okay, it will ask you a input field where you have to write your token, right? The parameter which is a token. So the token has to pass there. So if I click execute without passing the token, it will validate here. Okay, I didn't write any of the validation function to make this, right? I just put it's a required field. So this framework has taken care, it has to be there. Without that, it won't allow us to execute. So for this demo, I allowed one token, which we will try and executing it. So on click of this execute, it will actually make an API call to the server, this server, okay, where your API is hosted, and returns the data. If you see here, this is the query URL which is constructed, right? This is a query URL which is constructed, right? If you see localhost, okay, v1 till here it was my server, then it was this subject was my API name where token which I passed in the parameter, in the query parameter. So if you see a server response, the status code is returning 200. So for 200, what the response it was there, the same response it is returning here. Okay, if you have not documented any of your response, okay, and that response unexpectedly your API is returning, then here the status code will appear. Also it will appear undocumented, That means you can see it's a very intermediate issue. You have not documented, but it's still occurring. That means it's a very intermediate issue. So the another API, what I told you, it will return the subjects for a particular year, right? So this API, everything is similar. Okay, the only change here is the year, right? The year which the you want to return the subject, second year, third year, or fourth year, which year subject you want to return, that you have to pass in the path of the API. That will appear in the path of your API. That's my API created. You can create your own API how it is there, how you require it. Then so if you click on the tryout here, it will ask two parameters now. One is token, which was there for the previous API as well, and another which is required for this API in order to return the particular year result. So let me try out this second year, and so on click of execute, it returned the response. Everything is same. Okay, the one thing you can notice here is a download button, right? If your response is quite big and they want to share it with someone else, okay, this kind of response is your, this API is returning, okay, you have to program accordingly, right? So that time you can just click on this download button, okay, which will download your response, which is, so you can just preview any of the editor. So this is how the sandbox looks like, okay? So dev process, right? So you have seen this big sandbox. So you might be thinking it's very difficult to build. You have to write so many things and all, right? There is, it's very minimal, minimal development time is required for this. In order to build the this entire sandbox, okay, you need to include the Swagger UI framework. Okay, in order to include this Swagger UI framework, either it can be done using CDN or just by cloning the Git repository of Swagger UI. Okay, so for this demo, I kept it easy, simple way. We'll include the files using CDN. That is, you have to include these three files: one CSS and two JavaScript files. Okay, and configuring the web server. As I told, obviously, if you are writing any of the web application, you will have a web server. You have already configured it. So then you have to write a JSON or YML specification, API specification. We will see how difficult it is to write YML or JSON file. So for this demo, I kept it, we will write it in the JSON. If you really wanted to use for YML, there are online editors to convert from JSON to YML or YML to JSON. Okay, so everyone can see, right? This is my main file where I'm going to include the Swagger UI framework, right? The first thing is a CSS. I have included the CSS file over here, and then two JavaScript files I have included using CDN. So once you included this, you see here one div Swagger UI. In the previous slide, there was one image, right, where you will write a specification which will render HTML, JavaScript, and CSS into that. So once that framework is generates all those, by including HTML, JavaScript, and CSS, it generates the UI, the sandbox mode, where it is going to render into the, your main file. You have to tell the framework that, okay, this is my place where you have to render all the created HTML. Okay? This is the part I will come later. First we will see how we can write a specification, API specification. So visible? Yeah. So as I mentioned, the Open API Swagger API, Swagger specification is also called as Open API specification, right? Now the version of this Open API specification is 3.0. So I'm always using the latest one. It's better to use the latest one. Okay. Now info. What is this info? Info, here you have to describe about your APIs. What is the version of your API, title, and the description. You saw here? Here, this is the title, version, and the description of an API. This is nothing but you just need to write these three. It will generate the HTML format. Then you see the server. Right, where my API is hosted, this is the URL where I have specified it. Then comes the path. Inside the path tag, you have to write your API specification. Particular, what is the particular API is doing? My API name is a subjects, right? Which is a get method, correct? So the get method I have mentioned here, get. So the parameter which is used is a token, right? You are seeing the I have specified one token. So that parameter you have to write in the parameter tag, which accepts more than one parameter, where the name of the parameter was token, which is in query, right? And the description of that parameter, why that parameter is actually required. And you see that red label over there, it's a required field. If you really want all, default the required is false. If you want to make any of the parameters as a required, then you have to mention this as a required equals to required as a true. Okay, then you see the, this is all about the request part, this part, okay. Then you have to document about how your response looks like, right, this one. How your response looks like. So you can document your responses, okay, by using the key as a key value as your status code. Okay, as I mentioned, my APIs are segregating the responses based on the status code. So I have mentioned a dummy response, okay, in order to understand the end user. So the for 200, what is the response is available. So the properties. Three properties. One is status, message, and data. The status, the type is string. The message, type is also a string. And data, the type is an object. With example, the dummy example, you can provide it here. It's continuously repeating. Once you know how to write a specification, then you can write it for any of them. It's basically a copy paste of each line. So the based on the same thing for other responses, yeah, I have documented the same thing. For 400 response will be the failure, right? And data will be null. So this is about the first API. The second API, what was the difference between the first API and the second API? In the second API, there was a one extra field you were passing in the URL, slash year, right? So how you can, how I wrote the documentation for that? The entire the specification is completely same to that previous one. The only extra thing we have to add it is, in the parameter, the one more field comes, that is year, right? So how this year is going to read? Because the year is a dynamic, user can pass either anything, 1, 2, or 3, whatever he can pass, right? Since it's a dynamic value, we are assigning this as a template, right? Year, it's a variable here. So the variable name, you have to use it in the field name. So whatever, if you pass 2 here, that will be considered here. So the parameter name, which is in the path, where the query was there, in, where the token was there in the query. Right, here the token is there, even since this is also required fields, this is marked it as true. So any doubt in specification? Okay, this is the part of the code I told you.
If the data that I'm reading from the server is not always safe, like the ingestion properties might change. Can it be very dynamic?
Properties are changing, then you have to tell that when and all it is going to change, right? It is not exactly that every time it is changing. If you are segregating your response for status code 200, it will be different. Or if you are for status code 200 only, if the types are different, as you mentioned, then you can use here one of. I have mentioned like for 200, this is the only data. For my API, I am saying that, for status code 200, this is the only type of data it is coming. In your case, it is going to be changed, right? That time, what you can do is, here there is a something called one-off, No, I have not included in here, There is something called one-off. If you specify one-off, it will show the least of the responses, possible responses, A 200 response may contain this, either this or this. So those one-off is a tag which is available for OpenAPI specification 3. It was not there for 2. That one-off, you can just check in the link I will provide you. There you can see the one-off tag is there. One-off tag is there. Also, you have a any-off.
That means I'll have to know what are the things that are
coming. Yeah, you have to. You have to know means this is, if you are going to write it, this one, the end users are going to use that, right? They should know. That means you have to tell them, these are the possible response I'm going to give you with this API. That means you have to document it. You have to tell that, these are the possible responses are coming. So, as I told, this is the part of the code I'll cover later, right? Window.onload, this is just pure JavaScript function where it's like init, right? Whenever the page loads, it will execute for it here. So in this, what I'm doing is, here I'm creating just a constant of the framework, This is provided standard. Then we have to tell the framework that where is my specification I wrote, Just now my specification which is available in subjects.json, correct? The URL we have to provide, where is my API specification is there. Then you have to provide the DOM ID, swagger ID. So that DOM ID is nothing but this div ID, I explained it, right? This is the place where you have to render the entire the sandbox move which is created, this one. It will be rendered inside that DOM ID. There are some of the other settings which are like validating URL cross origin. This I'm not going to cover today. This I'll since if you keep on using this, if you start building the sandbox mode, you will understand why these are required. These are little high standard. If you have any doubt, then I can explain you later of the components. Any doubts on this development process? Okay, that's it, your sandbox is ready, right? I didn't do any of the JavaScript or any programming language. Basically, a typical programming language I didn't use. I just did in my JSON, and it is, the sandbox is completely ready for me, including all the validations, right? Okay, next thing is made with Swagger. Whenever we hear about Swagger, I know most of them we don't know what is Swagger and what is Swagger UI, right? Even I didn't know one year before. So we may think like, Swagger UI is something, since one GitHub project and no one is using it, basically. But let's see who and all are using it. One is data.gov.in. It's an Indian government website. They will provide you APIs for the citizen or for students in order for analytics purpose. It's a free APIs which they will provide, right, Indian government. They have a set of APIs they have documented using the Swagger UI. It's not like anyone can't build any of the sandbox mode, right? If you are building an API, obviously anyone has the ability to build a sandbox mode. But the thing is, the time consuming. It takes a lot of time to build an entire framework with all the validation, URL, and those things, right? If it is available for free open source, then why anyone will go to build their own? Let's have a look how they are building it. This is the list of an API. if you see the API, it's a similar to what we have just now did, right? It's completely the similar way. If you see their parameters, they are using API key, required, and format, which is required, the same way what we did just now. Correct? So the second one who is using is Flipkart, right? Flipkart, how many of you use Flipkart APIs? Flipkart provides some of the APIs, like such as like placing an order, okay, and refund, payment, all those APIs are available, which can be included in the your Android web application, those APIs. Even Flipkart has documented everything, all those APIs in the Swagger. If you see that, this is some order management API. You see little UI difference right here. They are using the older version of the Swagger since the UI looks little different. Then even we are Unicode, we are using the Swagger for our clients. Okay, we have built our developers hub page using the we go and see. Since we did some of the tweaks in the UI, you see a little different here and what I have shown you in the demo. Okay, alternatives. Whenever we heard about being a developer, whenever you heard about like open source, right? What is the first thing comes to our mind? What are the alternatives for this? Because some of the, there might be a scenario where we are not able to include the Swagger into our project, right? We should know some of the alternatives. Now there is something called Redoc, okay? This is also open source framework. This is similar to the Swagger UI, where you have to write again either YAML or JSON UI. I would, in order to compare between Swagger and this, I would pick Swagger because of the community support. This is some of the developers who started there by their own project. In a similar fashion, there is one more alternative which is available, OpenAPI GUI, right? So this is a similar kind, some of the developers have started, this is also an open source framework. These are some of the references which will be providing in Twitter, I guess, so you can get from there. The code and presentation which is also available in the GitHub repository, if you want then you can just refer it. That's it from my end. Any questions, sir? No, we have not. So any reason you are asking that?
Yeah. Every time we update the code,
yeah,
we should the
yeah, there testing should yeah, happen. Exactly. Every time when you your API responses are going to change, right? So you are telling like, okay, we have to come and write a documentation over here. You have to update your documentation here.
No, continuous integration. Once you upload the code to your Git repository.
Yes. That can be done. That can be done. But for this demo, I have not included. Okay. But that can be done by using the Swagger APIs, which are available.
Any other questions?
How many are documenting the APIs?
You are documenting.